All right, welcome back. We just finished up chapter 7 in the Sermon on the Mount, and we're going to continue on with chapter 8. When Jesus was come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, there came a leper and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus saith unto him, See thou tell no man, but go thy way. Show thyself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. Now notice in verse 1 it says, great multitudes followed him. So he just got done preaching a sermon on the mountain here. And, you know, when you hear the truth, you either get with the program or you disappear. And apparently a lot of these people liked what they heard, and they wanted to continue following Jesus. And the second verse says, a leper came and worshipped him. Now, leprosy at this time was an incurable disease. And if you go to Leviticus chapter 13, pretty much the whole chapter deals with leprosy and the laws concerning it, and how they had to separate themselves because it was contagious. And also in scripture, leprosy is a idiom or an example of sin. Leprosy and leavened bread are often used to as examples of sin. So this leper comes and worships him, and he calls him Lord. Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. So there was never a question of his deity or his ability, because he called him Lord, recognizing the fact that he was the Son of God. And he said, if thou wilt. You know, he knew he could do it. He just knew it was up to him. Which was, so it makes me think he might have been standing around listening to that sermon. I'm not sure, but he was a believer. And Jesus put forth his hand and touched him. Nobody would have touched a leper back then. That was big no-no, because you might catch leprosy. But of course, Jesus knew he wasn't going to catch it. But I think the bigger picture here is that there's no sinner that is too vile for Jesus to touch. And that's a nice picture, I think, because everybody would have avoided this man. Like, literally, like he had the plague, because he did. But Jesus touched him and said, I will, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. So there was no, 12-step program or anything like that. With Jesus, it was an immediate healing. And Jesus said unto him, See thou tell no man. But go thy way, show thyself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. Now, for some reason, that jumped out at me, so I looked through the scripture, and 2 Kings chapter 5, Naaman is cured from leprosy, and he was a Gentile. And the only other instance I could find was in Numbers 12 with Miriam, but that was a different set of circumstances. God gave her leprosy, and Moses requested that he take it away, and he did. So that was not quite the same thing. But throughout the scripture, I could only find this one example. So, if you go back to Leviticus 14, pretty much that whole chapter deals with the cleansing of a leper. And it very well could have been that no one had ever used that and the priesthood. So Jesus went, said, for a testimony unto them. And by the time Jesus came, you know, the priesthood had degraded to such a degree, it was pretty vile. I'm not saying all of them, but it was pretty corrupt. So Jesus basically told him to go as a testimony, and all of God's laws are true. So I can imagine they were pretty shocked when this guy came in wanting to go through all this because he was cured of leprosy. Verse 5, and when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion beseeching him, and saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. And Jesus saith unto him, I will come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldest come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to this man, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh, and to my servant, do this, and he doeth it. When Jesus heard it, he marveled, and said to them that followed, Verily I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. So the centurion comes, and he calls him Lord, so his deity is not in question at all. He's a believer. Tells him his circumstances, and Jesus agrees to come heal him. And the centurion says he's not worthy that he should come, that Jesus should even come under his roof. Now, the interesting thing to note here is that Orthodox Jews would not allow Gentiles into their homes because they were unclean. So, for him to say he wasn't worthy for Christ to come under his roof, you know, pretty much states that, you know, he felt that he was unclean and he didn't feel like Jesus, you know, Jesus was too good. And he said, speak the word only. So he believed in the spoken word of Jesus Christ. And I got Hebrews 4:12 and Exodus 15:26 down here. So the centurion believed in the spoken word, and he used his military experience as an example, giving orders. And it says here that when Jesus heard it, he marveled. And there's only two times in the scripture where it says that Jesus marveled. And the first one is here, and the second one is in Mark 6:6. He marveled at the faith of the centurion, and he marveled at the unbelief of the Jews. Verse 11, and I say unto you that many shall come from the east and west, and shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said unto the centurion, Go thy way, and as thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee. And his servant was healed in the selfsame hour. Now the centurion said that he wasn't worthy that Jesus should come under his roof. And Jesus gives him a place at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. And that is a beautiful picture. And he goes on to say that the children of the kingdom will be cast into outer darkness. And I got a few verses here, Isaiah 66, where he talks about he's going to plead with them, which is means judge, and a few other verses here where it talks about outer darkness and the relation of, you got the wedding ceremony where the guy doesn't have a wedding garment. He's cast out. And one other one there. The unprofitable servant, where he doesn't invest his Lord's money. So the faith of this man grants him. He wasn't even asking anything for himself. In fact, if you go to Luke, you'll see that he wasn't even there. He had sent some of the Jewish elders to speak on his behalf, and back in those days that was acceptable, to have someone speak by proxy for you, and perhaps he felt they would have more sway with Jesus, being that they were Jews. So he wasn't even there. He had sent these guys to ask for him, and when Jesus was on his way, he sent some of his servants to say this part here. So Matthew, being a publican, was versed in shorthand, so he just, you know, condensed the story, so to speak. But they're both accurate. He didn't even ask for himself. He wasn't even there. He wasn't asking for himself. He trusted God, and he healed his servant. Verse 14, and when Jesus was come into Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother laid and sick of a fever. And he touched her hand, and the fever left her. And she arose and ministered unto them. So Jesus goes to Peter's house, and Peter's mother-in-law lives with him. So you can see why he wanted to go fishing all the time. Just kidding. Kid has a bad joke. Sorry about that. So his mother-in-law is laying in there sick of a fever. Jesus walks in, touches her hand, and she gets up and she starts serving them. And verse 16, when the even was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils, and he cast out the spirits with his word. Another reference there to speak the word only. With his word, and healed all that were sick. And I like these sentences. They're so short, and they say so much. Because you can just imagine if he's got a great multitude following him. He heals a leper, and he heals this guy's servants. And he goes to Peter's house and heals his mother. And then all this crowd is around, and he's casting out devils. And it says that he healed all that were sick. So I bet you couldn't get a Benny Hinn to walk into a cancer ward today, and when he walks out, there's nobody left because they're all healed. But Jesus Christ did exactly that. All that came to him that were sick were healed. And in verse 17, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sickness. I thought that was interesting because we always associate that verse with Isaiah. Well, of course, that's where it's quoting from Isaiah 53:4. We always associate that with the cross, but it's interesting that this prophecy is fulfilled prior to the cross. So he actually bore their sicknesses and infirmities, and he was talking about this instance here. So there has a dual meaning to this. And a lot of times that's the way it is with prophecy. There could be more than one meaning. So he actually took their literal sicknesses and infirmities and healed them. Now when Jesus saw great multitudes about him, he gave commandment to depart unto the other side. And a certain scribe came and said unto him, Master, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest. And Jesus saith unto him, the foxes have holes, and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head. And another of his disciples said unto him, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father. But Jesus said unto him, follow me, and let the dead bury their dead. So the first guy says, I'll go with you wherever you go. And Jesus tells him that the foxes have holes, the birds have nests, but he doesn't have a place to lay down. Basically telling them to count the cost, and if you're going to serve God, it's going to cost you something, but in the end, those things will be not nearly as costly as you perceive them to be in the beginning. And he calls himself the Son of Man. This is the first time he mentions it, but he calls himself Son of Man 79 times in Scripture. And it is as the Son of Man that he will judge men. And if you go to 1 Corinthians 15:45-47, Philippians 2:9-11, and it talks, and John 5:26-27 specifically talks about him judging men as the Son of Man. But these other ones talk about his name is above every name. And then this one is talking about the first man, Adam, and the second man, and Jesus, of course, being the second man. You know the verse, wherefore is by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. And so that's the first Adam, and Jesus was the second. So calling himself the Son of Man is his, his Jewish name would be Son of David. And his divine name would be the Son of God. And his fleshly name would be the Son of Man, or his earthly name, I guess. But he uses that title more than he does Son of God. And just an interesting little tidbit there. Jesus had no permanent home, and we're just passing through also. This world is not our home. And those are the notes I got about the verses where Jesus' name is above every name. and the second guy here, He asked if he could go bury his father, and what he was asking was basically, I have my father either living with me or my father's still alive. Can I just wait until he's dead? It wasn't that his dad had just died and he wanted to attend the funeral. And Jesus said for him to follow me and let the dead bury their dead. And he's talking about spiritually dead. I got Ephesians 2:5 for that one. Verse 23, and when he was entered into a ship, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves. But he was asleep. And his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. And he saith unto them, Why are ye fearful, O ye of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. But the men marveled, saying, What manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? So, of course, his disciples, the majority of them, or quite a few of them, were fishermen, and they had great experience out on the Sea of Galilee. But this was a great tempest, and it says that the ship was covered with the waves, and they're freaking out. These guys were seasoned fishermen, used to being out there, and they were scared, but Jesus wasn't too concerned. He was asleep. And his disciples came to him and woke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. And I have the disciples' prayer right here. And you notice immediately he answers their prayer. And I have a few verses here where God controls the elements. Joshua, the sun and the moon stood still. That was in chapter 10. Chapter 3 is where the Jordan River stops so they can cross over on dry land. Exodus 14 is where they parts the Red Sea. In Genesis 1:2, the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. He's always been in control. He created them. And of course, he has control over them. And that's what manner of man is this. So, verse 28, and when he was come to the other side, into the country of the Gergesenes, there met him two possessed with devils, coming out of the tombs, exceeding fierce, so that no man might pass by that way. And behold, they cried out, saying, What have we to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God? Art thou come hither to torment us before the time? And this was pretty interesting to me, just in the fact that the demons knew who he was. This account is also in Mark and Luke, and it only describes one man. I'm assuming he was the spokesperson for the two, because it says there were two men. So they were possessed with devils. They were fierce men, so much so that nobody could come through that way. I was like, let's go there, because those two crazy guys are there. And of course, the demons recognized Jesus Christ, and they cried out, saying, What have we to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God? Art thou come hither to torment us before the time? So they recognize Jesus as the Son of God. They know that they have a set time to be tormented, and they know that he is in charge of it. And there was a good way off from them a herd of many swine feeding. So the devils besought him, saying, If thou cast us out, suffer us to go away into the herd of swine. And he said unto them, Go. And when they were come out, they went into the herd of swine, and behold, the whole herd of swine ran violently down a steep place into the sea, and perished in the waters. And they that kept them fled and went their ways into the city, and told everything that was befallen to the possessed of the devils. And behold, the whole city came out to meet Jesus. And when they saw him, they besought him that he would depart out of their coasts. So the devils asked if they could go into the herd of swine. And if you study scripture, you know that these demons, these devils, are not fallen angels. I believe 2 Peter chapter 2 verse 4 and Jude 1:6, there's only one chapter, but Jude verse 6 pretty much says that the fallen angels are already in chains waiting for the judgment. So a little bit of speculation about what the demons are, and And you know how that goes. You can get into some pretty crazy stuff, but some people think they may be the disembodied spirits of the Nephilim or the giants from Genesis 6:4, because it says there were giants in the earth in those days and also after that. And if you go to Numbers 13:33, it talks about the giants, and then in Deuteronomy 3:11, Og, the king of Bashan, he was 13 feet tall. So I'm not saying that I necessarily agree with it. It's just interesting to look into it. So I wrote it down just as a talking point. So feel free to look that up or not. It's up to you. But the important thing to note is that Jesus Christ had power over the demons. It wasn't even a question. As soon as he walked up, they knew who he was, and they knew he was in charge. And I think that they need to be embodied, because an angel can manifest himself as a human, and you can find that in when God comes to visit Abraham before he goes to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. He had two angels with him that looked like men. So they can manifest themselves in human form, but the demons need to be in a body. And here they request to go into the herd of swine. And Jesus told them they could go. And it could be that Jesus forced the swine to run violently down a steep place into the sea. I'm not sure, but that's what happened. And of course, the guys that were keeping the swine were pretty upset. And if you go to Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you'll see that the demons that were inhabiting this man were over like 2,000 demons. They were called Legion. So it wasn't just a couple of demons these two guys had. It was quite a few. And so it must have been a large herd of swine. And it says many, so I'm sure the guys that were taking care of the swine were pretty upset. They lost a lot of money that day. And of course, it says here that the whole city came out to meet Jesus, and they asked him to leave. Like, just get out of here. Do that. Don't disagree with what you're doing, Jesus, but you can't do it here. And I'm sure if you've been out witnessing, you've heard that before. So, like I said, they'll do it to him, they'll do it to us. So don't be discouraged. That's pretty much all I have. I hope this has been enjoyable. Thank you for watching. Maranatha.